In a market where marketers have to do more with less, which is the case right now, it's natural that they flock to the tried and true channels, such as Facebook. But of course, these channels have changed a lot, and what is working is a moving target. So how do you get the most mileage out of your Facebook accounts and your Facebook campaigns? Well, that is the key question. And it's the one we're going to answer because today we're talking with my guest, Tim Hyde, CEO and founder of TWH Media. If it doesn't ring a bell, that's not a problem. What will stay with you is a lasting impression because this is a social media marketing company that has worked with Amazon, DreamWorks, and Adidas. More importantly, the most spend on Facebook, because this is the biggest independent spender on Facebook ads in Europe. So Tim, first of all, welcome to the show. And I have to ask you, what's it like to be such a big spender?
Oh, well, thank you very much for having me. I suppose with regards to, you know, how much we spend on Facebook, that comes with a lot of pressure. You know, a lot of businesses, big and small, really rely on us to obviously maximize those budgets and obviously generate trackable results, whether that's, you know, revenue from e-commerce businesses or downloads and in-app kind of purchases like we help generate for a couple of gaming companies. So it's a lot of pressure. You know, I think every ad account has different kinks to it and different ways and sort of strategies that really work. But, you know, it's a nice and kind of fun, constant challenge of always trying to kind of get the most out of people's budgets, however big they are.
Probably a couple perks to that as well. I mean, in the old days, you would have said you probably have Facebook on speed dial. I won't date myself there, but what do you have to do? What does one have to spend on Facebook ads to say this, to be the biggest spender?
Yeah, I think I don't think it's a, you know, an official title, but, you know, in the last couple of years, I've spent well over sort of 150 million, consulted on a lot more of spend as well, even if it's not me actually executing on the advertising myself. And so, yeah, I think last year I spent something in the region of sort of 23 million pounds on advertising, which generated some really, really good results for clients. You know, we had certainly in the e-commerce space a real boom and a real improvement in conversion rate. And, you know, those brands that were aggressive with their spend really, really were able to capture the market. And that definitely paid dividends from a revenue perspective.
What about the verticals? You started there. You talk about commerce. You do have a strong background also in gaming. I mean, is it the same verticals, the same split you're seeing, or has that changed? A lot of newcomers, a lot of different types of verticals?
Ooh, very good question. I think one of the things that I've always enjoyed is you know, basically splitting my talents across different verticals because they come with different challenges, different budget constraints, different sort of creative opportunities. So, you know, in some people would find fintech, for example, really boring, whereas, you know, kind of breaking down the barriers and sort of educating on people on banking. So I did a lot of work with Revolut in sort of 2019 and helped basically build out their paid strategy, which was, you know, a huge project. Certainly getting to work with, you know, a fintech unicorn is a real honor. And that had, you know, certain challenges with, you know, the kind of aggressive growth that they wanted, and also making sure that we kind of worked with sponsorship partners that were also funding some of that spend. On the flip side, you know, gaming, you know, that for me has always been about really iterating with creative, coming up with, you know, really great hooks, showing gameplay, potentially even, you know, sort of highlighting whether it's, you know, involved with winnings and kind of gambling, and obviously being able to succinctly sort of intertwine, you know, what the rewards are for those games. So it really depends. But, you know, my specialty is the kind of nerdy ins and outs of Facebook advertising, how to really kind of get the best out of those budgets and structure campaigns in certain ways that can maximize your spend. But the day-to-day kind of different challenges between verticals is what kind of keeps me excited. You know, it's not just every day doing the same thing. Every different brand, every different budget has different challenges, and that certainly keeps me on my toes.
So let's do that. Let's be a little nerdy. Let's talk about the things that are a little bit outside of the box, a little bit different. Tell me about a marketing campaign, an initiative, you know, marketing initiative, something that you've done that had maybe results that even surprised you.
Oh, it depends how far. I probably should do one from recent memory, because that's more applicable to this day and age. But a long time ago, we launched a Kickstarter campaign, which was like a projector for the Nintendo Switch. And I think we spent $16,000 and generated just over $500,000 in revenue. And there wasn't really any other marketing. Now, obviously with Kickstarter and Indiegogo, the tracking isn't that precise, but you know, this was the predominant kind of source of traffic and kind of the most of the marketing collateral went on basically Facebook, and we were able to drive, you know, serious levels of sales on that kind of product. And that from a ROAS perspective was certainly up there with some of the best things I've ever done. One of the things that we've done more recently, you know, I think depending if you know you're working with sort of premium or luxury brands, there isn't always the opportunity to discount. And actually, I think last year we did a really good job with a couple of you know Black Friday, Cyber Monday, or to be honest, Cyber Month campaigns, which allowed a lot of the ads to optimize over a longer period of time rather than you know kind of having an all or nothing strategy over just 3 or 4 days. A campaign that I'm sort of really proud of, so one of our biggest spending clients is called ASOS, so not ASOS but ASOS. They're like a high-end cycling wear company, and they've just partnered with Alfa Romeo's F1 team, and actually they did a pre-order really expensive jersey, but they were able to obviously leverage that Alfa Romeo brand, like basically leverage amazing creative of this sort of, you know, cycling jersey and the car. And it just felt really, really cool. And that was some creative that we sort of got sent, and I was really excited to launch. And, you know, in platform ROAS of sort of 5 or 6x on a, you know, pretty decent amount of spend were really good results over the last sort of 3 weeks. And so it really does show that if you have, you know, a great product, great, you know, brand equity and good creative, that kind of holy trinity still does play in the kind of Facebook arena and still can, you know, really generate some phenomenal results.
I like that you put it together like that, because that ad creative, that is so critical. But the formats, you know, the kinds of ads that perform best is also really important to understand and to make that combination, to make that connection. What kind of ads are you seeing perform best on Facebook?
It really depends. You know, I think obviously from a hook perspective, and certainly where, you know, Instagram's going with kind of the adoption of a TikTok-esque feed, you know, video certainly in the upper funnel allows you to communicate more more things about your product and brand. It allows you to highlight the USPs of a product better, also gives you more kind of flexibility on how you can then iterate on that creative. So certainly in the upper funnel, I think it's a pretty accurate generic statement of video content tends to work really well. And then I think in the lower funnel as well, actually you tend to see images and, you know, really good, you know, image-based creative, carousel-based creative in that lower funnel, just because images do have that slightly higher click-through rate. Now, you know, that's not a sort of one-size-fits-all approach, but that is, as a, you know, a pretty broad statement, video in the upper funnel, you know, images in the lower funnel tend to sort of work a little bit better, but it really depends on the ad account, quality of creative, and all of the rest of those things.
Well, it's good to have a rule of thumb, you know, video in the upper funnel. Now, there's a downside to that, because when you look at the cost for video in the upper funnel, you know, it's not a cheap ad format. Let's just put it that way. And you have to continually refresh. Video is not what it's made out to be, but it is really impactful. You don't just specialize in understanding audiences, targeting spend, and getting the best results. You're also very focused on getting the most mileage out of each and every user. What are some ways that marketers can do that? They can squeeze the most juice out of every user in their campaign.
I think that's a really great question, because actually, you know, it's very easy for marketers to just say, oh, we need more creative, but you know, whether that's a shoot that's on location that's, you know, hard to kind of get to, there are budget constraints for a lot of brands as well. And actually, you know, my job tends to be, squeezing the most juice out of creative. So I think one of the things is, you know, being really specific with your briefing and really getting to sort of understand what things are moving the needle, what's the click-through rate looking like, what's that thumb stop rate looking like, and how can you actually analyze creative on some of those more indicative metrics, and then start to understand, right, how can we either rejig a video, or how could we add motion or an overlay to actually really gain the user's attention? So, you know, as a, again, a generic statement, the first 3 seconds in a video creative are by far the most important. If you, you know, you need to get straight to the point, you need a clear creative hook right at the beginning, whether it's motion, color, you need to grab that user's attention and actually iterating with those first 3 seconds, even if the rest of the video is predominantly the same, you know, at the end of the day, if you're, if it's a game, if it's an app, if it's a, you know, a bank, the proposition and the USPs are going to be a lot of the time the same. So really trying to play with those first 3 seconds of where you're going to see the most impact. And then, you know, if you're trying to kind of get that creative to get go even further, optimizing end cards, having slightly different, you know, call to actions on end cards, that these are sort of all these aggregated 1% marginal gains that can really help you just squeeze the life out of a creative and stopping them fatiguing.
We started by talking about the importance of the creative, but it's also got to be matched to that audience and probably the context as well. And we've got a very important context coming up because we are in the summer months and it's when you should be thinking about the season, you know, the holiday season, whether it's Christmas, whether it's Singles Day for APAC in November, it's a big deal and you start early. What about on Facebook? When do you start? How do you start? What are some tips there? Because marketers will be coming back from the summer and they will be thinking about this.
Well, that's really funny. I actually tweeted yesterday. I saw the first Christmas ad from Fortnum & Mason. So in fairness to them, they were advertising their advent calendar. So in all fairness, that, you know, that's a gift for December 1st. But, you know, we are in August and I couldn't quite believe that I was seeing that. For me, that's probably a little early, but a lot of the time it depends on, you know, stock on, you know, creative, how ahead of time brands tend to be. But if we take, you know, Q4 and specifically November, Black Friday, Cyber Monday, Christmas sales, you know, some of the e-commerce brands, 40% of their yearly revenue comes in those 2 months. And you really, really need to maximize that kind of key period. So planning way ahead of time is really important. But if you take, you know, let's just say Black Friday, Cyber Monday, we've, for a lot of brands, really tried to turn that into Cyber Month instead of just having a really short window, certainly based on the budgets that they want to spend. Again, you know, 40% of their yearly budgets end up being in sort of November to sort of December 15th as well. So it's not even 2 months. And the more time that you allow ads to optimize gives you a little bit more flexibility rather than, you know, setting campaigns with crazy high budgets in a really constrained time period. It's a real risk or reward strategy. So trying to, you know, reduce friction, reduce risk by having a slightly longer sales period is one of the ways that we've kind of tried to kind of combat that. But, you know, at the end of the day, for November and December, everyone is vying for the same eyeballs and it's a really competitive time and you need to make sure that, you know, your audiences, your strategies, your messaging is bang on, because if you miss, you miss badly.
Indeed. And that's what you try to do. You're getting everything you can out of every user, out of every creative. But of course, hey, we're heading into a bear market. There's no way around it. And it's going to impact everything. How have you seen it so far impacting campaigns in general? And how should marketers be prepared for this? As they say, winter is coming. There's a perhaps less funding, less UA funding. You know, you can't just spend it on UA anymore. A lot to prepare for. Give me a top tip.
Oh, very good question. I think I'll probably have to answer that in sort of two parts. So, you know, from the kind of upper funnel acquisition perspective, it's definitely more difficult in this kind of market. You know, inflation is kind of at what, an all-time high. You know, the cost of living crisis that we're sort of going through in the UK is really reducing kind of customer spend. Conversion rates on sites that are definitely going down, and you know, marketers are having to work harder both on kind of campaign level, creative level, and making sure that their offers and products are as compelling as possible, because it's harder to, you know, convert those users. So absolutely, I think all agencies across the board are really feeling that, and actually I think it's a case of, you know, not taking that basically working harder for it and not just being able to run an ad and assume that you're going to get, you know, hundreds of users, really good cost per install or great return on ad spend. Actually, I think everyone is having to, yeah, squeeze more juice out of creative, squeeze more juice out of specific audiences. And that's certainly in the upper funnel. But I think the biggest thing is also, you know, as marketers understanding, right, well, we have managed to convert users. How can we really start to nurture those people, whether it's, you know, CRO tactics, whether it's sort of exporting custom lists and upselling, again, existing customers in kind of more succinct and specific audiences. There are kind of that post-purchase funnel ways of basically, yeah, sorry to use the phrase again, squeezing more juice out of users. And that's something that we've had a real focus on this year is, you know, kind of keeping that constant communication with converted users, with customers, whether it's, you know, looking at referral mechanics, whether it's looking at upsells or additional discounts or bundling, or a real focus on kind of rewarding those users that you have been able to acquire, because we also understand that, yeah, UA costs are basically higher than ever.
So cross-sell, upsell, making a bit of a comeback. You tell me a little bit about how you're approaching this, but I'd like to unpack that just slightly and understand the real tactics, the ones that are sort of the simple ones to start with, because of course, without all the user level data, it's a little hard to target specifically. And if they didn't give you, you know, opt-in for email, or you don't have their telephone, you know, mobile number, you can't text them. So what are some of the, I would say the first steps, because for many marketers, they have been focused on acquisition and now they're thinking about, okay, I have that customer. How do I get back in touch? What are some of the steps to kick off that relationship, to spark that conversation?
Oh, I think again, you know, a lot of these answers will always come down to kind of compelling creative and sort of, you know, winning that feed in the kind of first 3 seconds and making sure that you are advertising
Let's talk about that frequency, because right there, it's the first 3 seconds to get their attention. What about that upsell? How soon after the first purchase or interaction? I mean, when do you come with the next one, I guess is the question.
Oh, I think that depends on vertical, if I'm honest, and will probably, you know, depend on the life cycle of the product and also the kind of ticket value. So I think if you look at, say, things like info products, I think it's so important to kind of get, you know, past that level of intent and getting some sort of conversion really within sort of 24 hours. So if you think that a traditional funnel will look like, you know, video ad to landing page, potentially, you know, a free webinar, something like that, which would be unlocked but via email. Let's just look at that as that kind of front stage of a funnel. And then post that, there would be an email, potentially a booking a call, or potentially, you know, some sort of course or blueprint following on as kind of more paid products. So for example, if you've got that kind of lead, you've had someone that's watched that webinar, they're in that mind of like, oh, you know, they're looking to improve themselves. They're taking time out of their busy day to obviously watch your content. I think you need to be really quick and follow up really, really quickly with that, you know, probably CRO and kind of email marketing, which is important to kind of get them, you know, later down the stages of the funnel. I think, you know, if it's sort of a lower average order value, so let's just say it's like a token purchase or an in-app purchase for you know, a game or a lottery, I think that basically period can be much longer, because you don't want to annoy that customer. You want them to enjoy that game. You don't want them to feel like they're getting bombarded by your messaging. So I think it depends on what vertical, but the most important thing will be you've got to optimize and you've got to test and learn. You know, I think basically the marketers that are doing the best are, you know, measuring things to the nth degree. And even if they know that the results aren't 100% accurate what they're tracking, at least, you know, it's inaccurate across all the different stages that they're tracking. So you do have some data that indicates, right, okay, if we message someone in the first 24 hours, we're getting X percent conversion rate, you at least can then make decisions based on data rather than, oh, if I was a user, I'd find that annoying. Well, actually, you might find that users don't find that annoying, and I might be completely wrong. So yeah, making sure that you're analyzing the data tends to be a really, really important thing with, you know, upsells and kind of nurture sequences.
Let's switch gears for a little bit. Let's talk about hot topic, metaverse, yes. Our friend Meta, which I'm hearing so much about, and I do mean a lot. There's so many brands, but you would expect them. They're the big consumer brands, and they're talking about metaverse. They're setting up their places and spaces in there. It's almost a land grab in the metaverse. How do you feel this will affect marketing, and how can marketers prepare for metaverse advertising now? Because it's going to be coming. Not everyone's going to jump into it like a McDonald's, a Taco Bell, the usual suspects, Gucci. But there are a lot of marketers who have to pay attention to that, because it's always best to be on top of a trend, not behind it. What's your advice?
I think, you summarized it there. It's best to be on top of a trend rather than behind it. And I think it's the mitigation of risk, which is why a lot of brands have jumped on it. I think there's also kind of that cult following of people that are, super invested into crypto and Web3 projects that are also early adopters and actually have, now have more brand equity with some of the brands that have jumped on it, just because they're now operating in what is basically their world. And with the metaverse, it actually feels like kind of their world. I think my broad take is, Web3 is the next evolution of the internet. I think marketing on there, certainly in the early days, will be a lot of brand plays, a lot of, collaborations, a lot of building trust and brand equity, like we've seen with, Nike and Artifact, and they're really understanding how to do drops the best way and how to kind of reward that sort of early mover or early community. But I think, there's also a lot of pitfalls for brands. I think, whether it's kind of gas fees or, brands doing things that aren't kind of authentic to them, it's not a case of just you have to go do it. Because you're going to get left behind. I do think that brands need to be strategic with how they're operating, how they're communicating with that community, what platforms are they communicating with that community on. And so, it's not as simple as, oh, just jump into Web3, launch an NFT project, or, buy some land on, one of these kind of platforms. I think the metaverse is definitely going to be here to stay, but I do also see it as like a slow sort of evolution. And, I think it's interesting to see case studies of brands that are doing well and, just kind of saving that away of like, oh, what did I like about that project? What did I like about that marketing strategy? And basically making sure that, if you are looking to roll something out, that it still links back to your brand or your product. I think doing something for the sake of it, certainly this, more crypto, more, technology-based community will see right through. So, although, we said at the start, you don't want to be left behind, I also think that if you miss, actually that will have a real damaging effect to your brand.
Couldn't agree more. What about yourself? Are your clients saying, hey, come on, Tim, I want to do something in the metaverse, maybe just to satisfy my CEO or my CMO? What's it looking like there? What's the pressure on you to be amazing in the metaverse?
I mean, yes and no, actually. I think LA-based clients, there definitely seems like there's a real hub of, whether it's kind of unlockables or tokenization of products out there, that seems to kind of be the most forward-thinking kind of clients. Certainly from like a fashion perspective, they're thinking of how can we, had free tokens with drops, or can you also, if you buy this product, what do you unlock? And I thought that was pretty interesting. I suppose from a UK perspective, I think people are really starting to look at it from a brand perspective rather than, obviously a performance perspective, and what can they do to start slowly building something, or what would actually be, a specific NFT drop, or what would those unlockables help with? One of the cool case studies I saw, and it kind of came from a podcast, was Mark Cuban, who is the owner of the Dallas Mavericks. So, he's not doing this just to make money. He's doing this to reward the community. And what I thought was really cool and a great use of the technology was they were giving fans sort of free tokens that they can then trade if they came to the game early, based on, every time they went to a game and scanned their ticket, their wallet would then be airdropped a specific token, and they can go on and sell. Now, the reason I thought that was interesting, because he didn't want his fans or their fans, hating the Mavericks and hating him when the market peaks up and down. He's not doing it for that. He's not, it's not a pump and dump scheme. And I thought that was a really lovely way of looking at, NFTs and tokenization, of rewarding fans and letting them, if they want to go and buy and sell them, but the actual acquisition was free, because you completely remove sort of the downside of the crypto market, which is, you can lose a lot of money. And I thought that was a really nice way of kind of incentivizing people to get to games and bringing the energy in the arena, but also, you know, a great way of kind of using the technology. So yeah, I thought that was a cool one.
Now you think about that, you're absolutely right, because you're rewarding, but your reward is also that when they get there to the game, you know, it all kicks in, that whole sort of aftermarket of engagement and merchandising and all of it. So it's actually a smart move for him.
He's a smart man indeed.
I mean, let's face it, if it's going to be something on the edge, it's going to be him and the cutting edge. But we're talking about what changes in business. We have metaverse, we have an economic climate that isn't going to be an easy one either. Going to require a lot of imagination, creativity. And we went over that. And thankfully, Tim, you're a sharing man, and you've given us some top tips to go away with around video, around frequency, around length. What's going to stay the same for marketers?
I mean, this might sound like a lazy answer, but, you know, I think old school marketing principles will always hold true. You know, I think so much research has been done by marketers, and actually I've just been operating in a new landscape like I would be in the metaverse. So obviously understanding how to really evoke emotion in users is always going to be important. Understanding how you can actually build a brand and build those multiple touch points with a kind of key consumer is always going to be important. And actually at the end of the day, having a great product, whether that's based on repeat purchase or, you know, referral, because you want to share, you know, that great product experience and that great buying experience with someone, all those kind of key core marketing principles, I think, are going to stay true for a long time. It's just the landscape and the technology that we use to kind of basically market to consumers are the ones that are changing. I think, you know, one of the things that is also going to be interesting is how affordable are these platforms going to be, you know, moving forward. You know, actually, is something like TikTok going to help stabilize the kind of CPM sort of fluctuations, because they still, you know, they still are a much cheaper advertising platform to market on. Facebook has this, you know, dominance that, because, you know, people are hooked on that drug and need that, you know, need those UA numbers to keep the VC funds happy, that, you know, so the lifeblood of so many e-commerce businesses is the revenue that can be derived by Facebook. Actually, are there, you know, more platforms coming into the space going to help even out the market? I don't know, but I also see Facebook being, you know, serious players for a long time to come. And I don't think Facebook marketing is going anywhere, but it is getting tougher and tougher, and you have to test more. Your creative has to be more compelling. You know, you're vying for almost less eyeballs and against more brands. You know, it's getting more competitive. It's not just, you know, brands within your sector you're competing against. It's practically all of them now. So, you know, marketers are going to have to stay agile and really understand what, you know, what moves the needle when it comes to great creative, great messaging, and a great customer experience.
And let's end on precisely that note, Tim. Let's boil the waters a little. I'm going to make you go out on a branch here with a couple, not predictions exactly, but make a call here. Players, platforms, you know, Apple is in ads big time. I knew it was coming. We talked about TikTok. So platforms, whatever you want to zero in on here, who do you pick and why? Winners and losers in this climate.
TikTok definitely seem, from a sentiment perspective, they're winning at the moment. I think, you know, the people that have done the deep dive into, one, the algorithm and where that data is saved and going, it's not pleasant reading, especially if you're American, based on, you know, that relationship with you know, communism and China. But, you know, public sentiment at the moment, people are loving TikTok, people are spending more. The relationship with advertisers, TikTok's done a much better job of rewarding advertisers and brands that have spent on that platform. I think, you know, Apple, they've been bringing out something for a while. You know, I think they had a record year for their advertising spend, and obviously that's predominantly on kind of, you know, App Store at the moment. But, I've said for probably 18 months that they are going to bring out a more broad advertising platform to take out a chunk out of this, $1 trillion market. And I think that's probably going to be the most exciting thing, you know, for me as a marketer, as it's been cool to test out the pros and cons with TikTok. I think Apple are going to be a real big winner. When they enter a market, they normally get things right. not also necessarily morally, but they do tend to get there in the end. So I think they'll be a big winner. I think TikTok are winning at the moment, but have serious downside. And although the sentiment on Facebook is really negative, both in the press and from advertisers, that, you know, they are still a real essential channel for so many businesses. And I think they are trying at least to combat all the pain that's come with iOS 14. So yeah, I think, you know, I think they're trying, but the challenge is significant, and that doesn't happen overnight. So yeah, it was probably a very political and safe answer, but
it had an element of being very straightforward. I could hear and read and listen between the lines, and that's always enjoyable to have you share what you know and what you do daily. Last quick question for you, because I'm just curious, because marketers ask me this as well, and it's like, you know, there's so much to watch, so much to do. What's your like daily routine look like to stay on top of this?
One of the things that's been really helpful to me is the kind of direct to consumer community on Twitter. It's, you know, building relationships with people over the years that are heavy hitters in my space, you know, other agency owners, agencies that I'm white labeled by, and having that kind of full spectrum across lots of really smart people and constantly checking in to see what they're thinking. So, you know, the ability to be able to do that on Twitter, the ability to do that on closed channels like WhatsApp and Discord and a couple of Slack channels of, you know, what are you seeing? You know, for example, over the last week, we saw that Facebook was spending sort of 70% of budgets before 10 a.m. Why that was, we still don't know, but that was a trend that we were seeing across multiple ad accounts, and also allows you to feel a little safer in yourself that, you know, this isn't something that I've done wrong. It's a, you know, a platform issue, and those things really help. I think, you know, I'm a huge fan of podcasts. I think consuming, you know, information from people in that medium, whether, you know, you're in the gym, on a walk, on your commute, that is something that, yeah, that data diet, I'm a big, big fan of lots of different podcasts. And I think, you know, Google alerts might sound really basic, but certainly when there's kind of platform updates, I'm a big fan of those. So yeah, that's kind of my data diet is really speaking to people, staying up, you know, up to date on Twitter. And then if there's any specific terms, having a couple of alerts on those and getting my information that way. And yeah, again, on that, a couple of newsletters that I'm subscribed to, yeah, always try and stay ahead of the curve, but sometimes fail miserably.
Well, you've got a really interesting routine, and you said yourself, you get connected and stay connected with people in your industry. Great segue, because I want to know how our listeners can do the same.
Oh, if anyone would love some advice, you know, reach out to me on LinkedIn, Tim Will Hyde on Twitter and Instagram. And yeah, if I can help anyone out, or even, you know, push someone in the right direction, always willing to jump on a quick call or exchange a couple of messages. So yeah, feel free to reach out, and thank you for listening to the end.
Well, thank you for sharing, Tim. And it was lovely to have you. And I have to say, now you're coming back. We're going to have you back in Q4. We're going to talk about the outstanding seasonal campaigns, some of the hits, some of the misses. But until then, we'll let you go for a little while. Everyone else, thanks for tuning in. Thanks for listening in. If you want to keep up with me throughout the week, you can email me, Peggy at mobilegroove.com is where you can find my portfolio of content marketing and app marketing services. Of course, DM me on social. I'm there, as is everyone. And you can also check out video, because if that's the way you want to consume it, it's there for you as well. It's powered by The Groove on YouTube. So until next time, remember, every minute is mobile. So make every minute count. Keep well, and we'll see you soon.